Hello everyone, my name is Katie Burt. I'm the book editor at denofgeek.com, and this is the panel, Is It Dark In Here or Is It Just My Book? We are joined today by currently four authors, but Libba Bray will be here soon, I'm told, so she can just join in whenever she gets here. First we have M.T. Anderson. Tobin is the author of Feed, which is the winner of the Los Angeles Times Book Prize. He also wrote the National Book Award winning The Astonishing Life of Octavia Nutting, Traitor to the Nation, Volume 1, The Pox Party, and the sequel, The Kingdom on the Waves, which were both New York Times bestsellers and Prince Honor books. He's written many other books for children and young adults and has a new book out called Landscape with Invisible Hand. He lives near Boston, Massachusetts. There's a lot of Boston and Brooklyn representation on this panel. We also have Danielle Vega joining us. Danielle spent her childhood hiding under the covers while her mother retold tales from the pages of Stephen King novels, which I think a lot of us can relate to. Now an adult, she can count on one hand the number of times in her life she's been afraid. Danielle is the author of the Merciless series, and Survive the Night. So thank you, Danielle, for being here. We also have Fred Van Lente. Fred is a lifelong, Fred is a lifelong mystery fan and the New York Times bestselling author of titles such as Archer and Armstrong, Marvel Zombies, and Cowboys and Aliens. He lives in Brooklyn with his wife, the playwright Crystal Skillman. And Fred has written, and his wife wrote together, a play about the life of Jack Kirby that I desperately want to see. Next we have Paul Tremblay. Paul is a multiple Bram Stoker Award finalist and the author of A Head Full of Ghosts and the crime novel The Little Sleep and No Sleep Till Wonderland. He is currently a member of the board of directors of the Shirley Jackson Awards, and his essays and short fiction have appeared in the Los Angeles Times and numerous Year's Best anthologies. He has a master's degree in mathematics and lives outside Boston with his wife and two children.
Boston! Good thoughts!
I'm also going to read Libba's bio right now, and I'm sure she'll be here soon. Libba Bray is the number one New York Times bestselling author of The Diviners, Lair of Dreams, the Los Angeles Times Book Prize finalist Beauty Queens, the 2010 Prince Award winning Going to a Vine, and the acclaimed Gemma Doyle trilogy, which, I read it along as a teen, so I'm really excited she's part of this panel, hopefully. She's originally from Texas, but makes her home in Brooklyn with her husband, son, and two sociopathic cats, which I kind of want her to write a book about. So we're going to start with a pretty broad question, which is, for all of you, what are some examples of humor in dark fiction, either in your own work that you're especially proud of, or something that you've read in someone else's work that you felt really blended those two elements together well, and why do you think it works so well? You want to start, Paul?
Okay, sure, that's fine. I would say one of my favorites is Joe Lansdale's Bubba Hotep, which was made into a movie, but a short novelette or novella. It's just, it's magical how he blends the horror and the humor. Because horror and humor, I think, are so subjective. I mean, most of us can intellectually recognize, oh, that's supposed to be funny, that's supposed to be scary, but sort of what, makes us laugh or what makes us actually scared, I think varies so wildly from person to person. So what Joe does, I think he just does it so smoothly. And I would also throw out an author who I think most people wouldn't necessarily associate with humor, but Shirley Jackson, Haunting of Hill House. There's a few chapters that are just hilarious when Dr. Montague's wife and this weird, creepy headmaster friend shows up. It's just really, really funny. And the same with maybe one of her overlooked novels called The Sundial. It's just a very funny, bitingly, satirical, maybe end of the world novel with this crazy aristocratic family.
And
so glad that you brought up the subject to me of both humor and horror, because when I first started writing horror, it struck me as kind of funny how similar it was to humor. Just like in humor, you're creating a setup for your reader, and you're really hoping that they won't figure out the end before they get there. You know, you want to set up the situation where you think you know what's about to happen, but when you get to the punchline, it's completely unexpected. So in horror, the stereotypical kind of cliche version of that is you have your hero walking down a dark hallway, and she keeps thinking that something's behind her, and at the end of the dark hallway, actually, it jumps out of, you know, an unexpected place. And it's very similar to how we set up a joke. You know, you're trying to set up a joke to lead the reader or the viewer to expect this one punchline, and then the real punchline comes out of nowhere. So it does follow some of the same rules, which I think is interesting. As for the actual question that I was asked, I'm going to cheat completely and not talk about a book, but talk about Scream, which was, growing up, probably one of the things that made the most difference to me as a teenager. And it kind of works because my nerdy friend and I actually, we wrote out the lines to Scream, so I did read Scream over and over again. This was the days before the internet was what it was today, so we had to get our little notebook and write the lines one by one, and then we would act out the first scenes of Scream together over and over and over again. Just to give you an idea of how popular I was, which was very. That's just when I think of humor and horror coming together in this like perfect marriage, Scream is always the thing that comes to top of mind. And of course, there are examples of actual horror novels as well, but you know, maybe that's just so perfect.
Well, maybe part of it is that for those of us who are like lovers of horror, you see the same patterns repeated so many times that some kind of variation, like you start to laugh at them regardless. You know what I mean? Like the little music box starts playing at the beginning of the movie. There aren't that many goddamn music boxes in the world. I've seen so many of these movies, and, you know, and the little child singing, and then, you know, all of those tropes come to seem so worn that you kind of want there to be something that kind of plays with that as well. And in a way, there's a great book called Men, Women, and Chainsaws, which is a discussion of the folkloric elements in horror, that talks specifically about how the idea of horror movies, that's what they're talking about specifically, is not to be original, but to tell the story we already know in a way with details that interest us. And so I think in a way that almost points to why it is that it's so easy for us to, like, you know, when we watch Troll 2, you know, to be my example, you know what I mean? Like,
as one does.
To love so much the fact that it actually is an incompetent movie that follows the rules, but so terribly that it's kind of wonderful.
Unintentional comedy.
Yeah.
What about the song The Monster Mash? Does that count as a terrifying tale of monsters standing together?
What ever happened to my friend? Something twisted.
Okay. I think we all hopefully all find comedy in our lives, and the great thing about putting humor in your writing is that makes it real. You know, humor is largely about details. It's also often about pain, and that's what horror is also about. You know, because it's always funnier when the person slipping on the banana peel isn't you. I've done a lot of horror. I've done, you know, Marvel Zombies is sort of a bizarre combination of superheroes and zombies. That's very funny. But I've been writing mysteries a lot lately, and the person I always think of is Elmer Leonard as a novelist, whose novels are not really comedies, but they do have a lot of humor in them, a lot of strange characters in them with a lot of funny traits.
Well, welcome, Libba.
Whoever comes up with a Comic-Con catheter will be a billionaire. But get jumpy.
Did you have an example of, you know, one of your favorite books that melds these two elements? Or either an example of someone else's work or your own work that you're particularly proud of?
Oh, wow. Are you talking about that straddles that line between humor and horror?
Mm-hmm.
It's funny because the first thing that comes to mind is the Bible. minister, and so you have like earliest influences, but you know, like when you've got Abraham kind of going like, hold on, watch this. Yo, God, like, yo, Abraham, I'm gonna tell him to sacrifice his only son. Well, just kidding. And to me, that was like an early influence. I was just like, oh, God's a psychopath. Charge, which was great crap, I suppose, for where we are now. Loving Stephen King.
Woo!
Because woo! Stephen King would terrify you, he would just scare the shit out of you, and then he would tell a fart joke. And then he would have kids being kids. And they would be funny and real, and he would have all of that human stuff, that pain, that awkwardness, and I just thought he did that brilliantly. I think he's going to have a real career.
We'll see. So I'm touched a little bit on this in your answers, but something that the panel description, I think, is pushing against is this idea of humor and dark fiction as two separate things that don't belong in the same stories. And, you know, for anyone who's lived, oftentimes these two things go together. So I'm curious what you all think about, you know, why it is that these two things often get put in separate boxes, if it's the result of, you know, a publishing industry trying to communicate something to potential readers, or if it's something broader culturally that makes us want to, yeah, separate these things in some way.
I think it's more arbitrary publisher thing, because I think there's an extremely long tradition, almost as long as the history of horror film and comedy film. I mean, when I was a kid, I used to love watching Abbott Costello and Frankenstein. I mean, so many of the, you know, movies in particular were not afraid to mix, you know, humor and horror. And as Danielle was saying earlier, I think it's a natural thing to have together. It's, to me, as a writer, my reaction to the daily absurdities of life is either to laugh at it or to cringe. And, you know, it's almost really the same reaction. It's almost just a little bit of a twist to get one or the other.
Yeah, I think that it comes from just a general misunderstanding of dark fiction. Like, whenever I talk to somebody who's unfamiliar with my work, one of the first things they say is, I would love to read that, but I don't like horror. And I'm like, probably you do. You haven't encountered the right form of it yet, or you haven't read the right book yet. But that doesn't mean you just don't. I mean, like, horror is so much a part of everyday life in the same way that humor is. That, like, saying that you don't like it is like saying, well, you know, I don't really like Wednesdays. So, well, but you're gonna encounter them anyway. You should probably try and find a way to figure out, like, to work your way through that intense dislike that you have of the day of the week. But I mean, I don't know. Like, your answer was perfect. It's been a part of the horror genre since there was a horror genre. I mean, when you go to the movies with your friends and you go see a horror movie, 90% of the audience is laughing at the biggest scares, because that's the reaction that you get when something truly horrific happens, is your adrenaline goes sky high. And, you know, we aren't in a place where we can, like, fight or flight, you know, so we laugh, because that's the only thing you have to do when you're encountering something like that. So I think that it's part of the same thing. And if you read a horror novel that doesn't have any humor in it, it's really boring, so there's that too.
I just feel like anybody who thinks that those two things are separate who never survived middle school.
Well, I mean, I think that there's like an idea that things that are supposedly serious, that is to say weighty, you're not supposed to laugh at. And if you do laugh at them, then there's the idea that you are somehow trying to protect yourself as opposed to opening yourself to the full, you know, awfulness of the experience. But I really don't think that's true. I mean, if you think about, like, people in really extreme situations, I mean, thinking about things like the tradition of really dark, grotesque, but funny writing in Soviet Russia, for example. And there is an example where their government has, and we are, you know, obviously headed this way, become so, in a sense, so senselessly, in their case, actually destructive as well as incompetent, that the only way to respond to it is to write about an absurdism that is almost cosmic. And that cosmic absurdism, that idea that maybe nothing will ever make sense, there is nothing in the world around us that is going to make sense, that is a very terrifying idea, but one that is best in some ways conveyed through human. You know, and so I honestly think that they go together in that idea of the sort of the grotesque, but we have a prejudice against that because, you know, we don't want to laugh at the funeral, but, you know, sometimes they put the casket in backwards.
Well, and I think that people worry that if they laugh at something that's horrible, that people will assume they're laughing at the thing. Does anybody know the podcast My Favorite Murder?
Yes,
everybody, because it's amazing. So this is two comedians who talk about serial killers and murderers throughout history, and they constantly get like shit from people who are like, oh, well, you're laughing at the victims, and they're like, we're not laughing at the victims, like, we're trying to make light of this horrible thing that keeps happening and try to understand it and try and talk about it in a way that's not terrible. That can be a difficult thing for people to understand, that you could deal with something horrible by laughing at it. By laughing in general.
I was just saying, it's a release, right?
Yes.
I mean, it's releasing attention in so much of life, as well as storytelling is about managing tension and stress, and laughter is a great way to sort of give that little emotional bow, give that little turn. That you have a scare afterwards. At least you expect it.
That they're primed.
Completely agree. And I was thinking about that great Carrie Fisher quote where she said, if my life weren't funny, it would just be true, and that's unacceptable.
I'm curious, for those of you who write primarily for younger readers, I know Tobin, Libba, and Danielle, you all do a lot of this. How does writing for younger viewers complicate this blend between horror and humor, if it does? Because I think a lot of people make assumptions about what younger readers can handle. And also, I'm curious if there has been in your career like pushback from either publishers or parents of younger readers about the melding of those two elements?
Well, I mean, I think the thing about being a teenager is you are literally living in some version of a horror movie or a novel. You're living in a dystopia because so many of your decisions are made by other people, and your own body is also something that is sort of, it feels monstrous. Times, and, you know, having to deal with sex and sexuality and all of that stuff. You're just like, you know, you're a roiling cauldron of hormones and other people's choices being foisted on you. So I feel like the thing that's wonderful about horror is that often, I mean, like, I myself was a very anxious child. I was sort of like a cheerful Wednesday Addams, and it was sort of like, we're all going to die, possibly horribly. I just read about disemboweling. That's licorice. And so I think that, you know, when your own body even feels that way, when you're constantly dealing with those things, to be able to name something, give it a name, call it a certain kind of monster, and be able to sort through it, to fight it, to accept it, to somehow make your peace with it, is wonderful. And you need that humor to be able to, you know, that arms you for battle. And so, you know, I have never had any pushback, actually, about content. Yet.
Well, and I would add on to that to say that teenagers themselves are all kind of little sociopaths. Like, I mean, no offense, you're lovely, and I was on too, but, you know, being in high school and dealing with just the mean people in high school every day, like, that's rough. And my first book dealt a lot with bullying in high school among teen girls, which is just terrible. Like, having been a teenage girl, oh my god, like, how does anybody get through that? I totally forgot the question in the middle of the answer. Oh, do I have any pushback from teens or readers for that? Honestly, the only notes that I've gotten in terms of content is that I could probably take it darker. So, and the teens can handle it. So once I got that once during my first book when I was kind of, you know, I was pulling punches a little bit, and since then I'm like, all right, let's go, let's do this. So it's been fun. I wonder if I've had more leeway to go into some of the darkness with teens than I would with adults.
And I would say, I mean, you know, I would actually agree with Libba. The thing is that a lot of that kind of like the grotesque, it is the combination of the dark and humor. It is part of your life as a teen, you know?